Hey there! In this video, we'll talk in depth about the exposure triangle and all you need to know in order to get perfectly exposed pictures. But first, let's roll the intro. By the way, welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name's Gabi and I'm very passionate about photography and travels, mostly on a budget. And well, I'm guessing if you're here, you may be passionate about them too. So why not stick around and leave a subscribe? It takes you 2 seconds, but it does really help this channel and you can always change your mind. So thank you. This is the last episode of a mini-series in where we talked about the three elements that compose the exposure triangle: aperture, shutter speed, and ISO. Today, we'll focus on the triangle on its entirety. We'll be giving a few definitions, answering some questions, and making some examples. So, let's go! I mean, we're not going anywhere, so actually you might wanna grab a drink and relax. But let's just not focus on those details. First of all, definition. For the billionth time, the exposure triangle is an equation between aperture, shutter speed, and ISO. Solving the equation means you took a properly exposed picture. Again, a properly exposed picture is one where there's no burnt highlights, blackened shadows, and you can see details in both said highlights and shadows. Now, the next question that naturally comes is, how do I solve the equation? How do I use the exposure triangle to achieve a properly exposed picture? Well, you'll need tools that can allow you to understand exposure. No, you don't need to buy anything. One of these tools is already in your camera and it's called exposure meter. The exposure meter comes in this form, both in your viewfinder and your camera screen. But let me show you from closer. So you see that as soon as I'm starting to change my setting, this triangle is moving up and down along the line. Well, here your goal is to get the triangle to line up with the zero. And that conventionally means that this is going to be a properly exposed picture. Simple, right? Hi, this is Gabi from the future, and I just wanted to quickly add that I know that this is a very fast and practical explanation, but the next week, Tutorial Wednesday, we'll be diving deeper on how the exposure meter works, and also we'll be talking about another instrument to better understand light. Also, since I'm here, if there's anything you'd like me to talk about in the next Tutorial Wednesdays, please leave a comment down below so I know. Okay, back to the video.
So Gabi, you're telling me that to get a well-exposed picture, all I need to do is this?
Yeah.
Oh, okay, cool, then.
But.
Of course there's a but.
You need to do it in order to help your picture to look good as well. Which then leads me to the next section of this video. Examples. Let's make a couple of real world examples. Number one, you want to take a landscape picture and everything has to be in focus. As you know from this video, a high aperture value means everything will be in focus, but it also means that less light will touch your sensor. Let's take a look to the light meter and wow, we need some more light to get to zero. You're now thinking about all the ways you could help your sensor to get more light, and let's analyze your options here. You could turn up your ISO, but if you do it too much, then your shot will get too noisy. You could lower your shutter speed, but then it means that if you don't have a tripod, any shutter speed under 1/60th of a second will result in a shaky picture. Or you could do a bit of both, bumping up the ISO a bit, lowering the shutter speed a bit, finding a good balance between them. And that most times is the best solution. The choice on how you approach your way to that zero depends on you, on the context you're taking the picture, and on the type of picture that you want to take. Did you bring a tripod or an external light? In this example, you can't have a low aperture because then it will result in parts of your image not being in focus, which is not what you want for a landscape in this case. This is what's really a bit tricky about the exposure triangle, because it's a very simple concept, but it requires a lot of practice. Now, let's make another example. You're at the seaside and you want to take a long exposure to get the water look smooth and silky. You know that in order to take a long exposure, you will need both a tripod and a very slow shutter speed of around a few seconds. That means a lot of light will come touching your sensor. Perhaps that's too much light. Let's have a look at the exposure meter. Yep, we definitely need to reduce the amount of light in order to get to zero. What's the options then? You could turn down your ISO to the minimum, you could get a higher aperture value, or in case one of them is not enough, you can do a bit of both once again. Are you starting to see a pattern now? It goes something like this. First of all, there's playing your shot and setting conditions to it. Like in this case, I want to do a long exposure. Then it's time to evaluate what kind of options you have in order to get a properly exposed picture. And then lastly, taking that properly exposed picture. I know this might seem a bit complicated and schematic of a process to do when you're taking a picture, but with enough practice this will just happen automatically in your mind without you even thinking about it anymore. Gotta practice, that's the only way. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is how you master the exposure triangle. Before I leave you though, there's one last question that I would like to discuss with you. Do I always need to take properly exposed pictures? And the answer is no, not at all. Photography is so amazing because it's subjective. Everyone can express their creativity however they want, and experimenting is just so much fun. Do you enjoy to take slightly underexposed pictures? Well, if you enjoy it so much that although you know how to take a properly exposed picture and how the exposure triangle works, you still want to take it, then go ahead, have fun with it. That will probably become part of your style. Now, I know that probably what I'm about to say was not necessary at all to be said, but this video wasn't meant to force anyone to shoot in a specific way. It was meant to teach you one of the basics of photography. And now that you have this knowledge and you know these rules, use them or not use them however you want. It's the beauty of photography. Well, I guess the real message that I wanted to come across here was take pictures purposefully, knowing what you're doing, how you're doing it, just have fun with it. And now that also this completely unnecessary part of the video was dealt with, we can start. Did you think I forget? We need some anime in this photography. Soon after leaving the Ninja Park village, our 3 heroes finally understood, for as much as they train, for as much as they are powerful, they can't reach the ancient land of the perfect exposure all alone. They need to join forces and work together to achieve their dream. It's the only way. And it's not an easy one. Strong enemies, difficult situation, and internal tension between them are a very tough problem to deal with. Against all odds though, after a while, our heroes managed to reach the walls of the legendary citadel. They couldn't believe it. They reached the perfect exposure, a dream come true. That's weird though, the city is empty. I wonder what could have happened. Walking around the desert streets, they eventually found the main city square. Empty, but a strange detail caught F-Chan's eyes. There was something written on the government building in front of them. Red lines that compose 5 simple words. The journey has just begun. Yeah. Well, I guess if you wanna find out, you should remember to subscribe to the channel, like this video and share it with your friends. If you enjoyed it, of course. And as always, I will be seeing you in the next one. Bye bye!